And what I want to talk about today is this theory that I've been working on with my collaborator, Lee Cronin, and a bunch of grad students and postdocs and other collaborators at Santa Fe Institute called assembly theory, which is an attempt to explain life from a perspective of a more fundamental understanding. And it has some really interesting philosophical properties of the theory that I'm hoping to touch on today, which I think will frame some interesting questions on the nature of what minds are as products of evolution and the fact that things that are complex are only structured by an evolutionary process and an informational process. And we need to take that as part of the fundamental physics. So when I approach the questions of minds, the thing that I think is most interesting as a physicist is not what a thing is, but what does it do? And what I mean by that is, does it have any causation in the universe? Are there measurable consequences for a thing existing? And so I've been thinking about the question of consciousness and minds for a while now, but the kind of question I really focus on is not the one of subjective experience, but if there are some things that exist only because minds exist and they would be a measurable consequence of a mind existing. And how does that actually structure reframing the question and how we think about the nature of mind and how we measure it? So as a preface, I'm not even convinced that consciousness is measurable as a property of individual minds. I think it might be a property of societies that you can measure over time. Which is pretty radical, but it's consistent with some other things, I think. So we're used to thinking about the hard problem of consciousness, and it's been excellently framed many ways as thinking about what it feels like to exist, at least for us. There's other hard problems that are related to this and maybe structured in similar ways, like the hard problem of matter, which is kind of a play on the hard problem of consciousness. So I think the hard problem of consciousness is more familiar to people. But the hard problem of matter is the idea that we actually can't measure anything, not just subjective experience, but anything about an object in the universe outside of interaction with another object. So even matter in some ways is equally mysterious to consciousness because you can't know its properties except when you measure them. And with my colleague Paul Davies, like thinking about the hard problem of consciousness and the hard problem of life, we came up with this idea of the hard problem of matter. We came up with this idea of the hard problem of life. And this really came from thinking about the origin of life. What is unique about the origin of life? What happens when life arises that we don't see in any other kind of physical system? And the idea we were really centered on was this idea that information seems to play a causal role. All right, so I might do an experiment. I won't do it. Well, actually, let's do an experiment. How about, can everyone raise their hand right now? Thank you. Okay. So what caused that to happen? You know, this is not like it's not a totally mysterious property, right? Somebody might give you an atomistic description, but it seems that a better description would be there was some informational property that emerged, say, you know, in minds that developed language over time. We all speak the same language. You understood what I said. That's embedded in a historical contingency that we share. And that informational property allowed me to actually cause things that you guys just did. And that sort of action at a distance that information seems to have is actually, I think, action across time, not at distance, but I'll get to that. But anyway, this seems to be the mysterious property, right? Information looks like it's causal. That doesn't sound quite right because it doesn't fit with standard physics. And maybe we could explain that by some mechanistic atomistic narrative. But so far, we haven't been able to reconcile these things. So I think when we're looking at these hard problems, whether we're talking about consciousness, matter, or life, they have some common properties. So hard problem of consciousness, existing feels like something. Hard problem of matter is that we can't observe anything to exist outside of interactions with other objects. And the hard problem of life, that abstractions and information matter in determining what can exist or what happens. I think the last one is certainly true in the biosphere, right? Everything that has emerged in the biosphere over its 4 billion years of evolution is the product of some information that was selected over time. So all of these hard problems in some way deal with the nature of existence. And this to me is actually the most fundamental and interesting unifying thing about them. And also one of the ways that it kind of confronts the standard way we talk about things in physics and why there might be problems. So the nature of existence, what it is to exist, is consciousness, how do we determine what things exist is matter, and how some things can be caused to exist and others cannot, which is life. So usually when we talk about the problem of what exists, people like to think about all possible mathematical objects. At least this is, I don't know how many of you are trained in, how many people are actually trained in physics in here, so I know, yeah. Yeah, we're the problem children, okay? Excellent. Yeah. So if you go into sort of a mathematical physics description of reality, you start asking these questions about, like, why do the laws of physics have the structure that they have? And we actually don't know. And most of the explanation for the laws of physics just gets pushed outside of the universe. So people assume their laws, they assume they have the mathematical structure they have. And then we have to assume an initial condition. And so these are boundary conditions put on the outside of the universe that no one has an explanation for. And when we get into the deep philosophical discussion of explaining why these laws, you know, one of the easiest explanations is to assume that all mathematical structures exist somewhere. So it's a different version of the multiverse hypothesis. Everything exists somewhere, right? This is also the many worlds interpretation of quantum mechanics. So usually our kind of scapegoat for explaining why some things exist and not others is to assume everything exists somewhere. And I don't find that particularly explanatory because it doesn't explain much about why things exist here the way they do. And usually, like, it's easy to talk about all possible mathematical structures existing and think that that's a real thing. But if I asked you the question again and I said all possible molecules, can all possible molecules exist? Does anyone think they can? Why can't they? Does anyone know how big that space is? Go ahead.
It's all geometry. Like, you could have, like, some connections between, like, atoms, but, like, there won't be any, like, topological, like, capabilities that really exist in that.
So this one's a topological constraint. Do you mean you can't make them all because of restrictions on, like, reaction chemistry?
I mean, you could potentially have them in an extremely non-Euclidean space, but not enough, like, sufficiently flat space.
Okay. I'm not sure I understand the argument, but we could get into that later. It'd be fun. So I think there's kind of a, yeah, go ahead.
The universe isn't big enough.
Yeah, the universe isn't big enough. I know, I set you out there. No one knew I had a setup in the audience. No, just kidding. So we don't have enough time or resources in the observable universe to make every possible molecule. And actually, we don't have enough to make every possible small molecule, like, you know, a few amino acids size. So I think what people underappreciate is how big the space of possible objects is, even if you look at chemistry. So chem informaticians have no idea, even though they do this all the time, how many possible molecules there are. Not every molecule will exist, let alone every human being. And I'm bringing this up because I think when people look at pictures like this of the Hubble Deep Field, they think space is big. And we're all taught space is really big, right? The universe is huge. It's billions of light years across. There's billions and billions of galaxies, and each one has billions of stars. And we are infinitesimal in comparison to this huge, vast space, physical space. And what we don't appreciate is that combinatorial space is really large. Right. So I was talking about the space of all possible molecules. This molecule that I'm showing here is Taxol, which was mentioned in the last talk. It's an anti-cancer drug. It is a very heavy, not very heavy, but it's a pretty big molecule. But if you wanted to iterate all possible molecules with the same molecular formula, it exists in this vast space of other possible configurations. And you have to ask the question, well, why does Taxol exist on Earth and not another molecule out of that space? And it's not like there's, you know, a couple other kinds of options. It's like there are millions of them. It's an exponentially growing space every time you add an atom to a molecule. So this space is really large. And as it turns out, the only place in the universe that we know that most of the space is even accessible is actually on planet Earth, because we have chemists that can do chemical synthesis, and now we have digitization of chemistry, which is using AI to automate the process and allow exploration of chemical space and synthesis of objects that would never exist anywhere else in the universe. I'm not giving an origin of life talk today, but when I do talk about the origin of life, I usually talk about the fact that we want to go out to space to look for life. And really what we should be doing is looking here on Earth in chemical space, because where aliens exist is in the possibility space of things that our universe can construct. And we can do experiments on this planet to look for it without having to worry about time to get there. And this is interesting to me because it makes it a tractable scientific problem, because you're testing a hypothesis in the lab and you're not just hoping life is common and you're going to happen to hit a planet that it exists on. You can actually start to make predictions about where it should exist. So this is sort of where I'm trying to go with thinking about origins of life, is how do we actually look in chemical space for alien life? Now, when you think about this space of possibilities, DNA is one molecule in that space. Proteins are, you know, well, it's not one molecule. It's many molecules in that space, depending on your sequence. Proteins are many molecules in that space, but they exist in this huge combinatorial space, and they're products of selection. And so I would say that information is necessary for those molecules to exist. They don't exist spontaneously for free. They have to emerge as a product of selection and evolution. So some people think DNA can just, you know, be found on Mars. I don't agree. And I'll give arguments why later in my talk. But this idea that information is necessary for some things to exist is not intuitive to us when we're thinking about molecules. Because I think a lot of people think that any complex molecule, no matter how complex, should be able to form in the universe outside of life. And I would argue no. Now, the reason I want to argue no is for the same reason that I think that satellites will not arbitrarily start forming on a planet and launching themselves into space outside of an evolutionary process. Right. So if you think about what's necessary for a planet to do what's called anti-accretion, so we know a familiar physical process is accretion, right? Planets form by gravitational accretion of more mass onto objects that are already getting more massive in the early solar system. Anti-accretion is kind of a weird process. It might happen by a fluke. For example, if a planet gets hit by an asteroid and ejects some stuff into space. But our planet is the only one we know of right now in the entire universe that has a reliable process of anti-accretion happening from the surface of the planet. That process is that there is a intelligent physical system on the surface of that planet that knows enough about the regularities of the laws of gravitation, some kind of information it's extracted from its physical world, to build little boxes and launch them into space, right? So that's the product of 4 billion years of evolution, acquisition of information and knowledge to constrain space possibilities to build satellites and launch them. And a feature of that is it's become reliable and regular. It's a law-like process on our planet. It can happen again and again. An asteroid hitting a planet launching something into space is obviously physically possible, but it's kind of a fluke spontaneous event. So it has a different quality to it.
To stay informed in an ever-evolving landscape, I see The Economist as a wellspring of insightful analysis and in-depth reporting on the various topics we explore here and beyond. The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments, whether it's in scientific innovation or the shifting tectonic plates of global politics. The Economist provides comprehensive coverage that goes beyond the headlines. What sets The Economist apart is their ability to make complex issues accessible and engaging, much like we strive to do in this podcast. If you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a deeper understanding of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. It's an investment into intellectual growth, one that you won't regret. As a listener of TOE, you get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/TOE, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now back to our explorations of the mysteries of the universe.